Welcome to the MMA Nerd podcast. I'm your host, the MMA Nerd.
What's up, guys? So today I'm going to bring to you the third episode of the MMA Nerd podcast, and I'm super excited for this one. We haven't had fights in a while, so this is going to be actually pretty much my first official pre-fight analysis type of podcast. I've been watching the fights and studying them, and I'm here to give you guys what I think of them and to try to explain some of the tactics and some of the key points that I think will be in these fights. And yeah, so I'm just excited to bring this to you guys. We'll see where this goes. I'm not going to talk a lot about, let's say, Fight Island and the pandemic and all this stuff, right? We already got enough of that conversation. The last two of my podcasts were kind of that. It was kind of like news and just possibilities of matchups and the pandemic and all that. And I really hope you guys are doing well. I hope you guys are safe and healthy. There's not much I can say much more than that. We're just going to go straight into talking about these fights. And UFC 249 is headlined by Justin Gaethje and Tony Ferguson. This is going to be interesting, it's going to be fun, and it's going to be a crazy fight. So let's start off with Cowboy Cerrone and Anthony Pettis. The first fight was a long time ago. Anthony Pettis won by a body shot. I think from there we saw that Cowboy Cerrone couldn't take body shots well. I think it was that fight that kind of started that. And then the Dos Anjos fight, we saw that as well too. The way Anthony Pettis caught Donald Cerrone in that first fight was Donald Cerrone wasn't really evading those body shots. He would kind of lean in with them. He would use his elbow to protect his ribs. The thing with that is he wasn't moving back as he was defending the kicks, so he would just kind of lean into the body shot, and what happened was Pettis's leg wrapped around his body. So even though Donald Cerrone leaned into the kick, he didn't move backwards, so Anthony Pettis was able to wrap his kick around his elbow and hit his body still, and he dropped him. So that was their first fight. Donald Cerrone usually comes in with a pretty narrow stance. He plots forward. His footwork is not sophisticated, I would say. He's mainly just in and out. There's nothing really fancy to his footwork. He even crosses his legs a lot. He would just walk forward. And you kind of see this common with guys that have narrow stances. The good thing about having a more narrow stance is that you can pivot in and out, which we'll talk about that more with Dominic Cruz, because even though you look at Donald Cerrone, you look at Tony Ferguson, and you look at Dominic Cruz, they all kind of have the same width in their stance, but they all treat it very differently, especially Dominic Cruz. He uses his narrow stance as an advantage to be able to pivot in and out and do all these shuffles and steps, and it's really interesting. But we'll get to that when that time comes. Donald Cerrone leans a lot as a reactional defense. He doesn't really, let's say, dip his head and come out at an angle. He'll just kind of lean. The problem with Donald Cerrone with leaning in a lot is that he has really long arms. So when he defends himself, when he brings his arms up to just shell up, he leaves a lot of holes because his forearms are so long, and that leaves holes in your defense. So that's one thing to really see in this fight. We saw this in the Justin Gaethje fight, where Donald Cerrone, because of his longer arms, he wasn't able to stop the really tight shots of Justin Gaethje. And that's also another topic we're going to talk about when it comes to Tony Ferguson versus Justin Gaethje, because there's kind of a similarity there with the longer arms and Justin Gaethje being able to come in and bomb on you. In order to fix these holes with his longer arms, he developed an intercepting knee and he developed a teep. The thing is the teep gets jammed a lot. He doesn't really have a lot of power with it. He kind of keeps people at bay at times, but at other times it gets jammed. His intercepting knee became really good for him when people try to come in the pocket against him, which obviously I just said he had that problem because he has really long arms. The problem with that is even though he has a good knee, he stands up really tall with it, and someone like Anthony Pettis can really come in and go over that knee. Anthony Pettis did that against Wonderboy. He used a Superman jab to get over that wide distance and base that Wonderboy has. He was able to take that space with that Superman jab, and who knows, maybe Anthony Pettis can use Donald Cerrone's attack of his intercepting knee as something that he can utilize to counter. Anthony Pettis has a lot more disciplined defense, as in he keeps his hand higher. What he does usually is if you're at a distance, especially if you're pop-shotting with him, he'll keep his rear hand up and he'll use his forward hand as a parry. But then once you come in with flurry, he has a pretty good Thai long guard, which he uses pretty well. Now, this is all pretty much used in front of the two black lines. So if you look at the octagon, there's two black octagons in the middle. If you notice, fighters behave very differently when they're behind the two black lines. That's because obviously the cage is there and they can't just back up. A lot of the times, a lot of fighters, like let's say Barboza, they get really flustered when they get behind the two black lines. They're pretty much different fighters. In many ways, you have to pretty much tailor your game plan differently when you're behind the two black lines, and you have to be able to stop the cutting off of the other person. And that requires a lot of nimble footwork and being able to kind of juke the person in many ways, right? You see Wonder Boy doing this well. You see a lot of fighters doing this well. Usually, if you want to be a good striker, you don't want to be behind the two black lines, because obviously you get behind the two black lines. Now, the person could cut you off a lot easier, and you have the cage right there where they can start firing off takedowns on you. And especially someone that is longer, it's a serious problem, because someone shorter can now get in on the inside in that pocket because you have nowhere to lean back. Anthony Pettis does really well in front of the two black lines. He likes to throw a lot of naked kicks. He would just throw a kick out there. If he does add to the kick, he likes to attack with a punch on the same side as his kick. So if you guys look at his fights, you're going to see he throws a kick and then same side, he'll step over, boom, he'll shoot a cross or jab of some sort on the same side, which I think will be interesting against Donald Cerrone, because Donald Cerrone a lot of times will just stay there and shell up or lean forward, and Pettis can take advantage and shoot a kick on the same side. Donald Cerrone stays there and he's able to just fire off shots. One thing Anthony Pettis does have pretty well is he has a good check hook, which could also be a problem for Donald Cerrone, because Donald Cerrone doesn't have the best hands and he leans a lot when he's throwing his cross, so that can be a serious problem for Donald Cerrone, Anthony Pettis's check hook. Now moving on to Dominic Cruz versus Henry Cejudo. Henry Cejudo typically now has a wider stance and he has a pretty decent understanding of his Maiai, which I said in the last podcast means distance management in traditional karate. Now, he isn't the most disciplined when it comes to the stance and utilizing his Maiai, because he doesn't come from a traditional karate background. This stance becomes very effective when going against somebody that comes in on a center line on you. And as you see, he does a really good job with people that come off on him on a center line. We look at the fight with Wilson Hayes. Wilson Hayes just came at him straight forward. Cejudo was able to just fire off shots. This style that he uses works really well. Like if we see this with Conor McGregor, for example, it works really well with open stances. Both fighters have an opposite stance from each other, so there's an opening that's facing each other. An open stance would be a left-handed fighter versus a right-handed fighter. And a closed stance would be two right-handed fighters or two left-handed fighters, for example. Usually you want to take a different approach when fighting somebody that has a different stance. This style works really well against someone that fights an opposite stance as you, creating an open stance, right? So Henry Cejudo does really good against people like that, because he, just like Conor, does a good job of, a decent job, of jamming your jab to force the cross to come out. And from there, they'll counter you. Now, this works really well, again, someone that comes off the center line, which Cruz doesn't do that. He pivots out. Another thing we saw with Henry Cejudo is that he has problems with leg kicks. Now, that is tricky to say, because we saw that he had problems with leg kicks with Marlon Moraes. Everybody has problems with leg kicks with Marlon Moraes. He has great leg kicks, very powerful, strong, explosive fighter, to the point where it's almost a disadvantage to him. As you saw, he gassed out against Henry Cejudo, and he was just winging shots. It was pretty crazy. He would throw everything into those shots. Nice technique, but he was just throwing everything into them, and I think that's what led to him gassing out. And we saw there that Henry Cejudo was able to adapt as well and come on the inside and dirty box with him. It was pretty great to see how well he adapted in the fight. That shows that he has the capability of adapting to Dominic Cruz in this fight as well too, and I think that's something to look at. We also see that Henry Cejudo, when he does have problems fighting on the outside and someone is really good at stopping him from coming in and out the way he wants to, he likes to come on the inside and dirty box a little bit. He also has a good inside leg trip, as we saw with Mighty Mouse, and he kept catching Mighty Mouse with that inside leg trip, and it was pretty cool to see how well he was able to come in and hit those inside leg trips. And that's something also to see when he's fighting Dominic Cruz. Just like Cowboy Cerrone and Tony Ferguson, Cruz has a very narrow stance. The difference is that he's able to pivot in and out and shuffle and try to come at you at angles that aren't just orthodox angles. He's not coming at you straight words and just throwing off 1-2s, he's coming and doing these diamond steps and these D'Amato steps and these shuffles, and it really changes things up. So it'll be interesting to see how Henry Cejudo deals with this difference of footwork and angles, and also the experience that Dominic Cruz has. He's such a veteran. He is coming off of a 3-year layoff, and that will play a factor, I believe. Most likely, right? We saw him fight against TJ after a long layoff. We've seen Dominic Cruz a couple times come out of a couple year long layoff, and he just performs pretty well. So it'll be interesting to see how Dominic Cruz adapts to this, and he believes that there's no such thing as ring rust. I'm not sure if that applies for every fighter, but for him, so far, he's proved that it doesn't play a factor for him. But time is ticking. He's getting older. We'll see how he deals with this. He's been injured a lot. He's had a long career, a lot of layoffs, and he'd even have a full training camp for this. This fight would have been super cool to see if Dominic Cruz had more time to prepare for this and he actually had a full training camp, because just like how I said in the last previous podcast, the Neil style footwork that, let's say, Dominic Cruz does, TJ Dillashaw does, Gavin Tucker also does, you see this Neil style footwork, and I would love to see that against a karate style, and that's what we're going to see now. In a way, we didn't fully get to see it against, let's say, TJ Dillashaw and Henry Cejudo. The fight ended so quickly, we didn't get to really see it play out. But this fight, I thought if it had more time for Dominic Cruz to have more time to really bring his A game, it would have been interesting to see how this played out. Now going to Tony Ferguson and Justin Gaethje. Just like I said with Donald Cerrone and Dominic Cruz, Tony Ferguson also has a narrow stance, which when someone has a narrow stance, like I said, you're more comfortable to walk forward, let's say, and not really use your fighting stance to come in and out. Because of this unusual narrow stance that he has, he's able to just, when someone comes at him with a shot, he's able to just step back and blade his body. And he does this sometimes several times in a row, where he'll just step back, blade his body, and he'll avoid the shot, taking kind of an angle. It's really interesting to see, and I think that's kind of what makes him unorthodox as well. As defense, he usually, like I said, steps back and blades his body. He would throw a check hook with it. He also likes to just lean back. He's so tall that he'll throw a jab. He knows one's going to come at him, and he doesn't even need to blade his body. He'll just lean back, and because of that, he'll also catch people overreaching, because he has very long reach, so he's able to just lean back and fire off shots. Another interesting counter that he does is an Imanari roll. That's not a very usual tactic unless you're Ryan Hall. His fight against Edson Barboza, he's using that a lot. He's using the Imanari roll to really force Edson to play a ground game with him. He just also Grambies out of things, which he will literally just Gramby out of a takedown, or if you hit him a couple times, and he would just turn around and Gramby roll, like kind of like you're playing Dark Souls. What Tony Ferguson has really interesting, he has a very long teep, but the teep looks kind of like a round kick, so it's hard to see whether he's going to throw a round kick or a teep. They're ugly looking kicks, right? They're not beautiful kicks, but they're effective. They're effective, and they're hard to read. Against people that like to shell up against him, he likes to grab their hands and throw elbows over the top or on the side, even down the middle. And Justin Gaethje obviously likes to shell up. So that'll be interesting to see if Tony Ferguson can capitalize on Justin Gaethje's shelling up and throw elbows and cut him up. Now, in regards to his long jab, he does kind of poke his head behind his shoulder. He kind of raises his head up pretty high, which allows people to come up over the top, over the shoulder, to counter him. And that'll be interesting to see how this plays out. One thing I do want to say about Tony Ferguson's ground game is that I believe his guard is a little overrated. Not saying he has a terrible ground game. By all means, he really doesn't. But I don't think his guard is a solution to Habib's ground and pound and to Habib's ground game. I know this isn't, we're not talking about Habib versus Tony right now, but I do want to bring this up, that I don't believe Tony Ferguson's guard is a solution to Habib. We can even see the difference between how Tony Ferguson, how he plays his guard versus how Habib just plays his guard. There's a huge difference in the two. Actually, if you look at Habib versus Abel Trujillo, you can see that Habib ended up in the same position going for that omoplata while the person's trying to step out and bring their knee through the stomach so they can spin around. You can see the difference between how Tony Ferguson dealt with that situation and Habib, because Tony Ferguson also was in that same situation against Kevin Lee, and Habib adjusted much better. He was able to go for a shotgun armbar, like under the armpit armbar, off of that situation, while Tony Ferguson kind of just got his guard passed and stayed in side control. Habib also got stuck in side control. The difference is Habib right away went into like an octopus guard, shift his hips out. He was able to do a technical stand up and get up, while Tony Ferguson, same thing, he got caught inside control, and the difference is that he didn't go to octopus guard. He didn't have much looks there. He mainly just tried to keep framing. Tony Ferguson was able to kind of push him off, shrimp, and get up to his feet. It wasn't an easy thing. He stayed there for a couple minutes under side control while Habib didn't. Also, Anthony Pettis for a quick second was able to get like an M1 stance on Tony Ferguson. Now, Habib is way better than Anthony Pettis in regards to guard passing. That's one thing I think will be really interesting to see play out. It sucks that we're not getting it, but I believe his guard is not going to be the thing that people think will stop Habib. Now, going on with Justin Gaethje likes to lean a lot at times. He shells up and he uses his forearms to block shots. He also does this when he's very stationary mainly. There's Justin Gaethje when he fights, he's really trying to get on the inside. And then there's Justin Gaethje where he shells up, he's more stationary, and he's looking to wing shots. Lately, Justin Gaethje seems to be more of the strategic fighter. Now, this is more of a short notice fight, so it will be interesting to see how this plays out. But Justin Gaethje, as of lately, he's more strategic. What he likes to do is he likes to get his head inside. And the way he does that is he will either dip inside while you throw a jab and wing some shots and gets inside. Or as you shoot in, as in like throwing shots, he'll come in, put his head really low, and puts his head onto your chest. And from there, he comes up and grabs a single collar tie. What he does is he gets a single collar tie, and it doesn't allow you to lean back. And then he'll go right over your shoulder. Let's say you're blocking, and he goes really tight, sharp hooks, and he'll hit right behind your shoulder into the back of your ear. He also gets really good uppercuts from there, because if you lean back, usually most people's reaction, they can't lean back. They try to lean down and around to try to take off that collar tie, and from there he'll hit hard uppercuts. I think this will play a really big role in the fight with Tony Ferguson. Every time you see Tony Ferguson get caught, usually it's from him throwing a long shot, usually a jab, and someone coming over his shoulder and hitting him behind his ear. And that's exactly how Justin Gaethje catches people. Especially if Justin Gaethje can come in and grab that collar tie. Just like Donald Cerrone, since they have long arms, this makes gaps in their defense. They stay really tall at times, and I believe that is how Justin Gaethje catches you, and I think that'll fall right into his game plan. I think it'll fall right into his strategy and into his fighting style. Now, I know there's a lot of other fights on this card. I know there's Francis Ngannou versus Rozenstruik, and that fight's going to be really interesting. I'm not going to break that down as much as I did these other fights, because I didn't really do a lot of studying on these fights. And also, I don't want to make this podcast too long. I want to keep it kind of short so that it's a little easier to digest for people, for new viewers and new listeners, because obviously my channel's still new, and to invest a lot of time into these videos, I know it's not easy for people. I want to make it digestible for people. So I'm going to make it short. I'm just pretty much going to go over those last three fights, which were Donald Cerrone versus Pettis, Dominic Cruz versus Henry Cejudo, and Justin Gaethje versus Tony Ferguson. And like I said, a big key here, guys, is Justin Gaethje has a big chance to win this fight due to those tight hooks that he throws and Tony Ferguson's tendency to stay really tall and have his head exposed after he jabs. Now, the thing is that when Justin Gaethje does shell up, he's in that stationary shelling position. That's where Tony Ferguson is able to just land shots. He has a super long jab, and that can force Justin Gaethje to kind of stay at bay and stay at range, and especially with those teeps, if Justin Gaethje stays stationary and he just tries to use his forearms to block, Tony Ferguson has all his tools to just throw leg kicks, body shots, and go for takedowns and Imanari rolls, and that can be a big problem for Justin Gaethje. So, I'm not going to go over all the other fights, like, let's say Olenek versus Verdum. That is an interesting fight. I went over it in my last podcast, and they're both the same age, and Olenek has way more fights than him. Olenek has a great ground game, but Verdum has an amazing ground game, and that will be an interesting fight to see. We have Uriah Hall versus Jacare Souza, and I believe that's an interesting fight as well, too. again, I'm not going to make this very long. I'm going to make it digestible for you guys, easily to just listen to, and it doesn't take up most of your time. And yeah, so that's the podcast for today, guys. Let me know if you guys want me to make content about anything, if you guys have any questions or anything. Again, I don't have a lot of feedback going on, so if you guys ask any questions, I'll definitely answer you. Thank you guys for listening. This is the MMA Nerd Podcast, and thank you. Again, thank you so much. This is, again, a dream of mine to do a podcast, and especially to do all this research that I did to break down these fights and then be able to give some analysis to you guys. And it wasn't a lot. I wish I could do fancy videos and do arrows and circles, and that's eventually my goal. But for now, I don't have the tools at my disposal. I don't have the skills to do that yet. So for now, I'm just going to talk to you guys about what I think I see in the fights. Eventually, you guys will get a better product and more visual stuff. So thank you guys for listening, and have a great day. And have a great couple of fights, because we have a couple coming up, and this weekend's going to be awesome.